Most of us think crime is rising, yet we're told crime numbers are coming down. So how likely are we to become a victim of violent crime? What happened?
I was just bottled from behind for no reason. Looked down, there's just blood everywhere.
Why?
There's no reason.
I'm Nick Ross, and I'm on a journey to find out the truth about crime. How much crime do we even know about?
Police figures are almost hopeless when it comes to measuring violent crime.
And what can we do to stop it?
I think you can halve the number of injuries. I don't think you'll halve it in a year. I don't think you'll halve it in 5 years. I think that in a generation, you might do it.
We've set up a unique experiment. We're taking one city and swamping it with cameras for a fortnight. We're filming around the clock with the police, the fire service, and at the hospital to build up a comprehensive picture of crime. And more than filming with them, we're collecting their data too. We're going to count all the crimes we find, and we're not just using the official figures. We're going to meet residents, get teenagers' perspectives, and carry out our own questionnaire to find the crime that goes unreported. Then we'll map it to reveal what crime in one city really looks like. We're calling it our crime audit. Behind the crime numbers are individual human stories. We'll be following the victims over the coming months to see how they're treated by the police, the prosecutors, and the courts. And beyond the criminal justice system, we'll see what could be done to prevent crime from happening in the first place.
This could be any street in any town in any part of Britain, and that's why we've chosen it. It's typical. And its crime rate is typical too. For the most part, people here rub along pretty well. But we're out to see what happens when they don't.
This is Oxford, famous as a university town. But we've chosen it because wherever you live in the country, there's a part of Oxford just like it. There are leafy suburbs, an industrial heartland, a bustling city centre, Victorian terraces, housing estates, and the city stretches out into countryside beyond. 150,000 people live here, and a further 30,000 commute in daily. Over the next 3 weeks, we're going to hear about the crimes that are likely to affect all of us at some stage in our lives: theft and antisocial behaviour.
But tonight, I want to discover the truth about the crime we hear about most, and that's violence.
Our first surprise comes right from the start of the audit. Hardly any violence is reported to police.
Control room.
It's now Friday, and their 999 call centre is quiet, as it has been for most of the week.
At the moment, we've got 16 jobs, but some of them have already been actioned, and they're waiting for me to pick them up again.
This, they say, is a typical weekday pattern. But then, as the weekend begins, in a scene repeated in towns and cities across Britain, the streets begin to flood with a new and younger crowd out to have fun in the city's clubs and bars. For the vast majority, it'll be just another night on the town. But for some, things will get out of hand. And as the evening draws in, the police arrive in force.
Saturday night, there is a fantastic police presence. They're almost swamping the main streets where the pubs and clubs are, stamping out any trouble before it really gets out of hand.
It's nearly midnight, and thousands have been drinking and having a good time. It's fairly quiet on the streets, but in the 999 control room, Inspector Peter Edwards and his team know it's not going to last.
The pubs are starting to empty out. Some of the clubs still have a couple of hours to go, so people are starting to drink. Well, I've been drinking quite a lot. You can guess what's going to happen. You start getting people getting rowdy, having arguments. That will probably reach a peak, you know, around about now, and start to drift off through the night. But, you know, you still get incidents happening at 2, 3 o'clock in the morning.
Yeah. violence is starting to kick off, much of it caught on police CCTV. Control room staff scan 42 locations, and as soon as they see trouble, they're getting officers to sort things out.
Hang on, she fucking whacked me out.
If we get a big fight or an assault or an incident, straight away we can have the CCTV looking at it and watching if there's any offenders leaving the scene, running away, and obviously we'll trace them.
A drunken brawl has broken out, and town centre cameras show several people throwing punches. The officers I'm with get there as fast as they can. But as we arrive, it's hard to know who's been doing what to whom. As police pursue the fleeing man through the city centre, their CCTV guides another unit towards him to cut him off.
Tell us his name.
Stand up.
Right.
I've done nothing wrong.
Keep your hands down for us.
I've done nothing wrong.
Keep your hands down.
It's all right. You didn't get yourself worked up.
I'm worked up because I need to act like a criminal and I'm not a criminal. I'm a teacher.
Okay.
I'm a teacher.
No problem.
I teach people how to speak English.
Well, this is an absolute classic, isn't it? It's been a fight. The guy running away from the police. He says the reason I'm running away is I'm a teacher, I had nothing to do with it. You were going to put me in the frame for the assault. I've got a suspicion this is one which is really quite a nasty fight and it's not going to go anywhere.
As more people leave the pubs and clubs, we see more victims of this alcohol-fueled violence. One man is unconscious on the pavement. I come across another outside the police station.
He started hitting me again. He hit me once. Look, stop, hit me, please.
This is the reality of violence on our streets. It happens mainly to young men, and it's random. If the police aren't there when it happens, it's extremely difficult to prove who's responsible. In any case, as the night goes on, I discover the system couldn't cope if the police did find more people to arrest. I'm looking in on the custody suite at Oxford's main police station. There's already a bottleneck.
Get the video camera! Get the video camera, man! Remember, you may see it again!
It's just after 1 o'clock in the morning. All the custody suites here at Oxford are now full. There are 17 cells, three quite serious offences. A chap in there accused of raping his wife. There's someone down there assaulting a police officer. Most of the rest are the sort of things you get on a Friday night, a fray, assault, stuff like that. But the fact is, it's full, and so are the next three police stations away from here. So the next arrest means that the officers have got to take their suspect to Reading, that's in the next county, and that's going to mean they're off the streets for the rest of the night.
The night's still young. We're alerted to another fight spotted on police CCTV. Four men attacked two others, and they're tracked as they leave the scene. But now the police have got the suspects, there's no room for any more prisoners in the cells.
What are you going to do?
If we can deal with things without making an arrest, then we will do.
Just because the custody suite's full?
Because custody is full. It doesn't necessarily mean we won't arrest. It might be that we can deal with it at a later date. Obviously, if we have to start ferrying people to Abingdon and Banbury, it takes up officers' time and then they're not out on the street.
Yeah.
It feels like a bit of a lottery. Your chances of being arrested seem to depend on whether you're caught early and there's room in the cells, or late when they may have to let you go. But how much violence do the police even know about? Our two-week audit doesn't just follow the police, we're going everywhere we can in search of crime. And in order to find victims of violence, the next thing to do is meet the doctors and nurses who pick up the pieces. This is the Accident and Emergency Department at the John Radcliffe, Oxford's world-renowned hospital which serves the whole city. We're filming around the clock here throughout our two-week audit. almost as soon as I arrive, I meet 18-year-old Johnny Rayfield. He was attacked at a private birthday do, and he's been brought in by his girlfriend, Lois.
John, that's a pretty nasty injury. What happened?
I was at a party with my girlfriend. I was just bottled from behind for no reason. Looked down, there's just blood everywhere.
Do you know who did it, who it was?
Yeah, I know who it is.
And you've told the police who it is?
Yeah, police are aware.
Was he quite drunk,
the guy? He was very drunk.
He was very drunk.
Yeah.
How often do you have to deal with injuries like this?
Well, obviously more on weekends, but we do see a lot of assaults to the face. They're mainly punches rather than bottles like this, but they do have them.
Hiya.
You were there when it happened?
Yeah.
Jonathan says there was just no reason for it at all.
No reason whatsoever.
There was no argument, there was
just
no nothing.
Sang happy birthday.
You just sung happy birthday? And a guy turns around and bottles him.
Thank you. No worries.
What proportion of your work on a photo session night is due to alcohol?
80-90% tonight.
80 or 90%?
I would say so, yeah. But from what I've seen.
You've had a lot of assaults in tonight, too?
About from 6 o'clock, I think we've had about 20 assaults in.
During the early hours of the morning, we see a steady flow of walking wounded, some quite badly injured. They're men who've been drinking or who've been hit by someone who's drunk. Sister Jules Stockbridge has seen it all before. She's been a nurse here at A&E for 19 years.
Every single one of the patients we've seen here who's come in as a victim of assault, it's been alcohol-related. Is that the typical pattern?
Yes, it is. You know, people lose their inhibitions. They'll say things that they wouldn't dream of saying when they're sober. And obviously, out of that escalates the violence as well. And the grim reality of ending up in an A&E department, you know, covered in blood, confused, in pain, you know, is very different than what you expected when you left to go out for the evening.
Johnny will be scarred for life. The police have arrested the party guest who bottled him, so over the coming months, we're going to follow his case through the justice system to see what happens. Meanwhile, as more and more injured arrive in A&E, I want to know what patterns there are to the violent assaults that we're seeing. Is tonight typical? And where does the violence happen? We've taken a whole year and mapped all the violence that was recorded as a crime. Each white light shows where an assault recorded by the police took place in the whole of Oxford over 12 months. And guess what? The red lights show the clubs and pubs. Most recorded assaults come from where there's the highest density of licensed premises. Alcohol is fueling violent crime. And since Oxford is typical of Britain, this is likely to be true of towns and cities everywhere. But this is just the violence the police know about.
What's really struck me during our two-week audit is just how many people have been brought here into hospital as patients because they've been victims of violence, but haven't told the police. Even though quite a few of them have been really quite badly injured.
Timmy, I know it hurts like hell to talk, is that right? Can you just very briefly tell me what happened? Was it a fight or what?
Not really, one-sided. I didn't really do anything back.
Well, somebody just hit you? And if you've been told they've broken your jaw? Oh my gosh, they need to split it then.
And straight across there as well.
So you've got two breaks in your jaw?
It's just that bit there is on its own apparently, it's just all
loose?
Yeah.
And you can see just here where he's fractured through his jaw.
It looks completely broken through,
is
it?
It's gone right through, yeah. So it's quite nasty. He's also got a fracture here.
Which is also broken through. That's quite a serious injury.
It's quite a nasty one, yeah, to go completely through.
It's going to need an operation to fix.
Yeah.
Right. Is he going to be okay at the end of it?
Oh, yeah, he'll be fine at the end.
Yeah.
But it's a pretty, you know, it's a pretty standard fracture. From our point of view, we see a lot of these.
Put them together if you can.
Despite an injury that will keep him in hospital for days and take several months to heal, Damien tells me he has no intention of telling the police.
Why do you want to get the police
involved?
Because,
I don't know, just... He didn't really seem the sort of person that I could really see in a threat. It was like a self-defense mechanism, wasn't it? To protect him and his girlfriend, and that's all it was. It was like, I just think he's wasting my time so much, I should really waste his, I suppose. But
what was it that started it? Somebody made a lewd comment about his girlfriend or something, is that right? Was that you? It was somebody else.
And it's because people like Damien don't report their assaults to the police that we asked the John Radcliffe Hospital to provide us with the figures they collect on the victims of violent crime. On this Friday evening, 12 assaults were bad enough to be treated at A&E, yet only 7 assaults were recorded by the police in Oxford that night. So there's a mismatch. And for nurses up and down the country like Sister Jules, this is the pattern, week in, week out.
Jules, you keep a tab at this hospital of injuries which are consistent with violent crime, even if the patient has not reported this as violent crime to the police. And it's surprising how many aren't reported.
Oh, yeah. They either don't want to be involved or they know who's done it to them.
Now, one would have expected it's just the very minor injuries that don't get reported to the police, but that's not what we've seen.
No, they're quite serious ones.
There's a guy in there, one of the most seriously injured we've seen. His face is a mess, he's got a black eye, but they're worried that he's got quite a bad head injury. He doesn't really want to talk to us on camera. He certainly doesn't want to have anything to do with the police. It's a classic example of a serious injury that comes into hospital not reported to the police that'll never make its way onto the crime statistics.
So, how typical is this? And how much does Oxford tally with the national picture?
Well, I'm on the way to Cardiff to talk to a man who knows more about this than almost anyone. He's a professor of maxillofacial surgery. In fact, he spent so long patching people's faces up after they'd been violently assaulted that he got fed up with it and started keeping meticulous records of how often it was happening. And he's persuaded lots of other hospitals to do the same.
Professor Jonathan Shepherd has now been tracking British violence for a quarter of a century.
So how did your figures tally with the police ones?
We found, for example, that 7 out of 8 assaults inside licensed premises which led to A&E treatment did not appear in citywide police records in Bristol and in Swansea and also in Cardiff.
So they weren't even seeing the glinting top of the iceberg. Everybody was just almost meaningless.
Police figures are almost hopeless when it comes to measuring violent crime because police recording depends on a report, and people we found don't report violent offences because they're afraid of reprisals, because they don't know who hit them, because they don't want their own conduct scrutinised too much. There's still an awful lot of incidents which result in people having a broken jaw, a broken nose and needing a hospital operation, and great expense incurred in the NHS which are not reported or recorded.
We wanted to find out more about who the police might be missing from their figures. For one thing, we've seen almost no violence involving children. Under-16s aren't represented in any national survey on crime, at least not till now. We went back to the city to conduct one of the biggest surveys ever undertaken to find the truth about crime against young people. 1,800 14 and 15-year-olds have taken part across Oxford state and private secondary schools. And for them, violence seems a part of normal life. The survey included middle-class kids like these, as well as those from less prosperous parts of town. All in all, nearly a third of boys and almost a fifth of girls told us they'd been kicked or punched in the previous month.
Have any of you been punched or kicked or hit, beaten?
I've never been beat up.
Neither, no.
None of you?
No. Although
I have heard of a lot of fights before. I mean, just the other day, last Friday, in fact, our school was a boy from our school and a boy from the private school had a bit of a fight, and the private school boy actually ended up with a jaw broken. And this was only last Friday, and he had to go into hospital, and they video recorded it, and I find that quite sickening. This is like him stamping on his head sort of thing. It was really, really horrible.
A third of boys and 1 in 6 girls told us they'd hurt someone else. And though some of this might be messing around, 1 in 10 confessed to carrying a weapon. So violence is routine, very real, if rarely thought of as a crime.
Think of fights among your own age group.
Yeah.
You're not frightened of adults down the street attacking you?
Just down the road, there was this guy, and he came over, and my friend was taking some cash out of the bank, and he just pulled out this little kind of flick knife sort of thing, started brandishing it around. I was like, you're going to help me out or what? You're going to help me out or what? And eventually, my friend just handed over 20 quid and
yeah.
Was pretty shaken up by that whole thing.
To find out more about the patterns of crime in our typical British city and how they affect you, come to our website at bbc.co.uk/truthaboutcrime and discover the truth about crime online. Meanwhile, another vivid pattern is emerging from our audit. Violence going on behind closed doors.
What's interesting is the number of cases where people are ringing 999 to ask the police to sort out things that are happening in their homes. Some of these just sound like noisy arguments, but quite a few are really nasty.
The majority of your jobs that come through are domestic related. If somebody's in distress or something and they're not able to talk, then sometimes you do get silent calls. But we're, you know, fully trained in that. You know, we can say, you know, if you can't talk, tap the headset and or the handset if you need any police assistance.
Domestic violence takes up a lot of police time. We've mapped all the domestic incidents where the police had to get involved. This is a whole year's worth, and it shows up some intriguing patterns. Domestic problems start over the breakfast table before the school and working day begins. Things are fairly constant through the day, building up again when people start returning home. But the real problem comes later, around pub closing time. Fights and rows then peak between midnight and 2 a.m. And dealing with it is often deeply frustrating for police.
A female called in reporting that her ex-boyfriend that she just split up with is hammering on her door trying to get in. So she's locked herself in the bathroom at the moment because she doesn't want to go near him.
By the time police arrive, the man has gone and the woman refuses to tell them who he is.
Very disappointing.
Absolutely nothing.
Absolutely nothing. She's a bit reluctant to make any form of complaint at the moment, which is quite often the case.
And it turns out it's not just women. The next call is from a man who says he was beaten by his wife.
What happened tonight then? You had an argument?
No, not a... When I came home, because yesterday she beat me, 2 days she beat me, she hit me very badly. I said, please, don't touch me because I'm already scared. Because she said, you tell anything to the police, I'm going to kill you. I'm going to kill myself.
The man's wife denies it all, and as is so often the case, it's highly confusing. She's eventually arrested and taken in for questioning, but no charges are brought. Remember, we've chosen Oxford because its crime patterns are typical of the rest of the country. Scenes like these are being played out up and down the length of Britain. Surprisingly, according to the British Crime Survey, the country's biggest annual report on our experiences and feelings about crime, 2 in every 5 victims of domestic abuse are men. And men or women, they often demand an emergency response.
So what's happened here? We noted domestic. Do you know anything more than that?
The only report that we've got is that it's a male that has assaulted a female at the location. When the air quietens down a bit, we might be able to get some history out of it, ask for previous details of the address, and it'll give us a bit more information to work with when we get there.
But they've classed this as a domestic assault in progress. That's a real emergency for you.
Okay.
Thames Valley Police give these call-outs the highest priority, and they help to cool things down. But it's often hard for them to take matters further.
He's gone.
People rarely press charges, and anyway, it's usually his word against hers.
Yes.
She's struggling to explain the whole circumstances, but I think they've had some sort of argument.
Why is she struggling to explain?
Thought she's had a bit to drink, so I think obviously those two have enjoyed a few drinks, which has exacerbated the circumstances.
A lot to drink,
you? Quite a bit, you know, yeah. You can smell it on her breath, which is difficult trying to get the circumstances, but they've had some form of argument. He's then decided to punch her twice in the face. She's got a bit of a lump under her eye.
That's okay, don't worry.
Will she press charges, do you think?
She's saying so at the moment, but on speaking to her, I think she's withdrawn previous complaints against him, which may assist us this time in saying to her, look, you withdrew it once, he did it again. Let's not go down that route again.
We found domestic incidents are a matter of routine, but only a fraction make it onto official police crime statistics. During our two-week audit, there were 103 of them recorded by the police that required their action. Of these, only just over half, 56, will be recorded officially as crimes. The rest, arguments and disputes, won't go any further. But a small number of domestic violence cases are really serious, and they're not always known to the police. So I'm heading off to a secret address to meet people who've been so badly hurt or abused that they've now gone into hiding. This refuge is the last resort for people who fled their homes in fear. They can stay here till they're rehoused safely. Three new cases arrive here during our audit fortnight, though only one has reported her assault to the police. Laura is one of the residents. Her ex-partner is trying to track her down.
Last night I was getting abusive texts and I was just ignoring them.
Are you keeping those texts?
Yeah.
I'm going to breach my tag and come to find you. Need to talk.
Another woman staying at the refuge is Jane. Her ex-partner has been charged with assault against her.
I would have had no alternative but to go and stay with a family member and live my life in absolute fear. Because he obviously knows where my family live, I'd probably be a nervous wreck.
Still frightened of him?
I'm terrified. I'm terrified because I think more recently the penny's starting to drop in my mind and I'm starting to realise the severity of how dangerous he is.
Are you going to go through with a court case?
Yes, I am. I have to. He's taken enough. He's taken more than enough from me.
Well, we'll stay in touch with Jane and with Laura, and we'll see if the criminal justice system delivers for them. What we're seeing in our audit of violent crime is that it's not strangers who are most likely to hurt us. It's people we're close to, or at least someone we know. And often, there's drink involved. But in week two of our audit, we discover a cluster of violent crimes that we've not encountered so far. Once again, the A&E team is in the front line.
Tell me what happened.
I just came out the club, I just got jumped.
Okay.
It's Thursday night, and two separate victims of violent muggings have just been brought in. Christopher Woods is 21, and Malcolm Hayden Smith is 23.
Going to clean where there's no wounds at the moment.
Malcolm and Christopher have both been badly beaten. They were attacked half an hour apart, but it turns out they were also attacked within 100 yards of each other on Oxford's Cowley Road. Two violent assaults could be a coincidence, but by mapping a whole year's worth of police-recorded crime data on violent assaults, it's clear that the Cowley Road is one of Oxford's two main hotspots. On the left is violence in the city centre, and to the right is the Cowley Road. Both have drink-related violence, but unlike the city centre, the Cowley Road doesn't have CCTV. By day, it's a busy multicultural district, packed with shops and restaurants, pubs and clubs. By night, it's Oxford's second busiest centre for nightlife. The day after his mugging, Malcolm has been discharged from hospital and agrees to show me where he was attacked. He's a graduate student. he has dyspraxia, which affects his speech.
And tell us what happened.
These guys came up behind me. They said they wanted to show me something, and they dragged me into the church and all the way behind
what,
the...
They took hold of you?
Yeah, yeah.
And dragged you in here?
Yeah.
And what happened then?
Then they kicked and punched me to the ground, and they grabbed my gadget bag and they ran off in that direction.
How often were you punched, do you know?
About 5 times. They
really?
Were both punching me to the floor. It really hurt. I lost consciousness for like 5 minutes.
Really?
Yeah.
Christopher Woods was also badly hurt, in his case by 4 youths. There were fears he had a brain injury, but a CAT scan the next day put him in the clear.
I remember getting hit to the floor, and I woke up again with my hands over my face, and I'd sort of gone into the fetal position just to protect myself, and I just saw, like, boots and feet kicking me in the face, and just then hands going into my pockets and taking my phone and wallet. I tried to flag down some cars and get them to stop and waved at them, but nobody stopped. Obviously, I was covered in blood, and people just thought, you know, he's been out brawling and he's drunk, and it just really hit me hard that nobody just stopped.
Will you go out just as much, or will you feel a bit fearful now?
I'll obviously be more aware, because I kind of underestimated the dangers. And it's really upsetting when this happens, because you're like, who can I trust now? I hope they get brought to justice and they see the error of their ways.
Do you think they will?
Hardly.
We're going to stay in touch with Malcolm and Christopher to see if the police find their attackers. There were no witnesses, and since there's no CCTV, it's not going to be easy. At the end of our 2-week audit, what does our typical city's experience tell us? Out of 150,000 residents in Oxford, 71 had to go to hospital because they'd been assaulted. That means about one person in every 100 would need treatment because of violence every year. The biggest danger is to men aged 18 to 30, and the biggest risk factor in all violence, by far, is drink. And whether in the home or on the street, only a fraction of it is reported, especially among kids.
So what happens to the victims who did tell the police? Their cases are now in the hands of one of the oldest, most renowned legal systems in the world. Let's see if it works.
Will police find the men responsible for the muggings of Christopher Woods and Malcolm Hayden Smith? Will any of the domestic violence victims get justice? And will the man who bottled 18-year-old Johnny Rayfield be convicted? The police arrested him that night before he left the party.
I have to look at it every day. It just reminds me of the night, really. And he's probably forgotten it already, and that annoys me.
Johnny was the first victim I'd met in the A&E department. I'm catching up with him to see how he's getting on while his case inches its way through the system.
John, what effect has this had on you?
It's had a massive effect, really. I don't really go out that much anymore. And no, there's also my physical appearance. It's all changed.
What was he like before?
I was always, like, really bubbly and quite hyper. But now he's, like, doesn't really want to go out that much.
Why? Do you know?
Because if he is a nice guy, then what's stopping anyone from doing it? It's a bit scary.
It's really shaking you up, isn't it? Big
time. It's understandable, really. It's quite an emotional thing to go through. It's obviously affected him quite a lot.
It's 16 weeks since Johnny was bottled. At the Crown Prosecution Service, Carolyn Oakley has been waiting for the case file. It's often hard to know where delays take place in the system. But now she has the papers, she faces a dilemma.
It is a balancing act between the aggrieved that we've got in this case, who, as I said, who's a young lad who's got quite a serious injury to his face that will be there forever and has affected him in an adverse way, coupled with the fact that you balance it against a defendant or a suspect who has never been in trouble before. He's an 18-year-old lad who's got, appears to have got very drunk and done something stupid. Moment of madness. So it is a difficult balancing act to make decisions about what you do with people.
In discussing the case with the investigating police officer, Carolyn is about to make a very important choice, and one that's not normally made in public. Her decision on what charge to bring is based on rules called charging standards and depends on the severity of the injury. Her choice could profoundly affect the rest of the defendant's life.
So if we look at the charging standards of a wounding, Section 20 carries a maximum of 5 years. A wound means the breaking of the continuity of the whole of the outer skin, which is exactly what we've got here, haven't we? Section 18 can be the same injury, but requires an intention to cause that injury. And a Section 18 offence is life imprisonment as opposed to 5 years. So it's actually a huge difference between whether we charge a Section 18 or a Section 20.
What do you hope will happen to him?
I hope that the punishment is quite harsh.
It might
sound rude, but I want it to be harsh. Because it was an unprovoked attack, and like, the stress it's caused me, you just can't even add it up, really. It's just...
So you'd like him to go to prison?
Well, yeah. Yeah.
You should just be taught a lesson. It should be an example to everyone that if you do something, you just got to pay the price for it.
OK, so we'll go with the 20. We'll re-interview him before we charge him, obviously.
OK.
Go from there.
Carolyn has opted for the lesser charge with a notional sentence of 5 years. If the defendant pleads guilty, he could reduce that sentence by a third. Malcolm and Christopher were two of the 10 victims of violent street robbery during our two-week audit. Both were mugged on the Cowley Road. And both gave a description, but though the police searched the area, they drew a blank. So how do they feel their cases have been handled?
Not very well, I don't think. I'm quite disillusioned with it all, actually, because I don't really think they took the time to actually investigate the case.
Really?
They said there was insufficient evidence. They just closed the case. And that's another thing. The police said they'd do an identity parade, or I could look at people on the computer, but that never happened.
The story is much the same for Christopher Woods.
About a week after I'd made the statements, I got a phone call from the robbery team saying, can you remember anything else? I said, no, I can't remember any extra details. And he said, OK, we'll be in touch. I haven't heard anything since.
So 3-4 months you've heard nothing?
No, nothing at all.
The police had had little to go on, so it's not surprising nobody's been caught. But it was the lack of communication that seems to be why Christopher and Malcolm feel so let down. Yet this is one of Britain's most highly rated police forces. Sarah Thornton is Thames Valley's chief constable.
So I've just come from talking separately to two different victims, both of really rather nasty assaults, one very nasty assault. They've hardly heard from the police, and they say, we don't seem to be very relevant to this process. Once we've given the police their information, that's it. We're out of the loop.
In terms of letting victims know what's happening, there are rules about when we're meant to tell people, and that should be happening. If it's not, then that is an omission. And we do put a lot of energy in trying to investigate them. They are hard to investigate if they've happened very quickly. People will commit street robberies where they know there are no cameras. So you see evidence of avoidance by criminals. And we've learnt over the years that the important thing is to try and get uniform officers there as quickly as possible, get the victim in the back of the police car, get them to drive around the area, see if we can identify the suspect really early on. You'd be surprised how often perpetrators will stay in the same area or not go too far, so that can be successful.
3 months after our audit, the council and the police installed 3 CCTV cameras on the Cowley Road. The press are out in force as the system gets switched on for the first time. It's reassuring for many local residents, but it's too late for Malcolm and Christopher, whose muggers presumably will never be found. What about our domestic violence victims, Jane and Laura? Will they see justice? In Jane's case, she's determined to give evidence, even though she's pregnant.
You're going to go through with the court proceedings then, for the prosecution?
Yep. Absolutely.
Absolutely. No, never.
Are you going to go into the witness stand? Are you going to go behind a screen? Are you going to do it via a television link?
The strongest way to give evidence in court is to stand in the box. My baby's my strength, and if I don't do it for me, I'll do it for my child.
We'll stay with Jane and find out the result. But in Laura's case, it won't get as far as court because she can't face giving evidence. That's even though the prosecution had prepared a file and her ex-partner was charged with assault.
I suppose the court system would work and protect women if people like you had more courage and prepared just to go through with it.
I just don't think we should have to go through it, though. I think I felt like I've been through enough. I didn't feel emotionally strong. I'm petrified. I felt like if I went to court, it would make him more angry.
For the manager of the refuge, Karen Diver, it's a constant problem in domestic violence cases where the evidence is often one person's word against another.
When these cases go to court, the incident they're talking about is one assault. Then how many have there been before then? If the woman gets the wrong detail about whether he slapped her on the right cheek or the left cheek, is she a liar or is it because she can't remember which particular assault she's talking about? And if there's violence, how many sexual assaults have there been? And if you can imagine being put on that stand and having to talk through everything that's happened, I can certainly understand that people are reluctant to report.
But even if victims are reluctant to give evidence in court, does the case have to collapse? Police in Barry in South Wales think not. They're one of several forces pioneering the use of an almost irrefutable evidence-gathering tool. It's good for any crime, but perfect for domestic violence.
Presumably the officer who's wearing this camera, he's not a cameraman as such, he's just an officer and it just happens to be pinned to him somewhere.
Absolutely.
It's just looking where he's looking.
And he's taken part in the raid as an active officer, you know, he can go sort of hands-on if he needs to.
Detective Sergeant Richard Williams has used the camera for many crimes, including domestic disputes.
It would be perfect for capturing, for example, the demeanour of the perpetrator, how aggressive he or she was. It would record how upset the children were. And, of course, it would also capture the demeanour and any injuries on any victims.
I hitched a ride with PC Russ Barnett to see what happens.
When you turn up at these incidents and you may have a drunk, abusive male who will turn round to you and make a comment like, she was doing my head in, so I had to slap her, they're more or less admitting the offence.
In a way, it's a godsend for the police, isn't it? Because so often when you get to court, there's this sort of tennis match about, do we believe the officer, do we believe the accused?
It's absolutely brilliant. There is no ifs. As you say, there is no question over what happened.
Russ's first call is not to a domestic dispute, but to a car smash, and the passenger is hurt. The driver is breathalyzed on camera, and he's over the limit.
I'm arresting you on suspicion of driving with alcohol on your breath in excess of the prescribed limit because you've provided me with a positive specimen of breath.
The passenger is taken to hospital, though later discharged. As a result of the accident, the driver was fined and disqualified from driving for 3 years. Then, just before his shift ends, Russ is called to a violent domestic incident. Here is the video evidence of what happened next. A man they've arrested in the street has a nasty head wound.
How did you get that injury to your head, mate?
Inside the house, Russ questions a woman.
Can you tell me again how David came to have his injuries?
Visibly shaken, she admits on camera that she stabbed the man.
What did you stab him with? Okay.
So, within moments of arriving at the scene, both the man and the woman are arrested. Russ has captured valuable evidence of the man's injury and the woman's confession.
Well, the camera's obviously successful. They take away from victims all that stress of having to do statements, appearing in court. They make it much more likely the offender's going to plead guilty, and that saves a fortune in trial costs. There's bound to come a day when cops just use cameras routinely. And just think of all the hassle that's going to save. Every time the evidence is disputed, we've got a replay. Do you see this becoming ubiquitous? Will every police officer wear one of these things in time?
That's the position I hope we're going to move to. I think we should try to move to the point where using a head cam or body-worn surveillance is part of, you know, what a police officer does when he or she books on for duty, puts on the utility belt and handcuffs and a head cam as well.
The head cam helps catch offenders, but only after a crime has been committed. So what more can we do to stop it happening in the first place? As we've seen, one thing we can do is map it. Spencer Cheney is a world expert on crime mapping. He works with Britain's best blue light services and with hospitals like the John Radcliffe, which check and share data that could help reveal crime patterns. By helping to see when and where crime occurs, we can introduce measures to prevent it.
Give me a practical example. How can you use this to cut violent crime?
Well, what we can do is we can pull together information from the police and from the hospitals and use that to then track back to identify if there are certain problematic licensed premises. There may be an issue with the training of the staff there, serving people when they've had too many to drink, or letting people into the pub or club when they've had too many to drink. If we have a persistent issue with a particular licensed premise, we may then consider taking their license away from them.
So if we really understand crime, why, when, where it's happening, we can intervene to stop it. And prevention is so much better than cure. Rather than spending millions, billions, chasing offenders after the damage has been done, we get there first. And after all, we've successfully cut violence in the past. We can do it again. Football is a classic example of how we got it so wrong and then we started to get it right. For years, whenever British fans went abroad, they were regarded as the scum of the earth. They shamed the country for their bad behaviour. Then the football clubs, the fans themselves, the police, they got their act together.
The clubs themselves were made responsible for stopping violence. They were made to pay for the policing. They were made to improve the stands and put in seating. They banned glasses and bottles, and they protected the crowds with stewards. Domestic football violence dropped dramatically so that families can now go safely to the game.
And violence around football grounds has gone down too, thanks to taking away one of the most common weapons.
The Cornwall pub is just round the corner from Cardiff City Football Ground. When there's a home game, they serve pints in plastic glasses. It starts 2 hours before kickoff, and they keep using them till 2 hours after the final whistle. It's not just here that they use plastic. On match days, all pubs near the football ground replace their glasses with polycarbonates.
Some of the guys over there were saying, we don't really like them, but actually, if we had these non-stop, after 12 months, none of us would notice. No, it would just, no. You agree with that?
Yes. Yeah, down the line, no one's even going to look back at it, really.
The customers might not always like it, but the hospitals certainly do. In fact, it was Professor John Shepherd's idea. 15 years ago, 10% of all the victims of violent crime at his A&E had been glassed or bottled. How many injuries did you save, and what proportion of savings did you make?
We saw a 70% reduction in the number of glass incidents. That amounts to around 60 or 70 a year.
In this city alone?
Yeah.
So across the country, this is going to save literally thousands, maybe tens of thousands of people from serious facial damage.
There's an awful lot to be gained from these situational type interventions, looking at safety in clubs, the surfaces on the floors, sorts of materials glasses and bottles are made of, all those sorts of things.
No, you stay.
Sit down, Keith. Sorry. Sit down, you're going to fall over. Sorry. Sit down.
There's another simple idea that helps cut violence. Professor Shepherd and his colleagues have studied the behaviour of drunks. And they've worked out something you'd have thought you hardly need an academic to tell you. Drunks need more space than sober people. Staggering into people in crowded spaces can cause spilt drinks and aggression.
The answer is more space, less violence.
Pubs that limit their numbers or are in pedestrian areas where people can spill onto the streets tend to have less violence. But ensuring more space is just one of a raft of practical solutions.
The thing is, will the drinks industry do voluntarily what the football authorities and others have achieved? Because if we want to stop the parade of injured victims coming through this place every weekend, then we have to make a step change.
I've invited three people who make, sell and regulate booze to consider possible ways forward. Tony Copes is a licensing officer. James Clark is a brewer. And David Poley is from the Portman Group, the public face of the booze industry. It's Friday night and I've asked them to come to Oxford's John Radcliffe Hospital, where we were based around the clock during our two-week crime audit.
Have you ever been into any unit like this before, any of you guys?
No, it's my first time.
Jules, by the time it gets to, say, 4 o'clock in the morning, what proportion of these cubicles are going to be taken up with people who are drunk or have been hit by somebody who is drunk?
Oh, I'd say 90% at least.
What about the change in the licensing laws? Did you notice any difference since licensing opening hours have been relaxed?
I think we're seeing an increase now of people who are intoxicated any time of the day. Now, I know you don't force people to drink, but I pick up the pieces every night, you know, and something's got to change. It can't go on like this.
Suppose we took a hospital like this, and we said, look, in 2 years' time,
our target is we're going to halve the number of people coming here with violent injuries which have resulted from drink. What do you have to do?
I think that alcohol itself does not automatically cause someone to become violent. In the end, it is the individual that has to take responsibility if they're violent, if they beat someone up.
If we try and break this down, because it's very difficult, could we get tougher?
One thing we've got to look at is the happy hour. The way that people can actually just pay a set fee to go out and drink as much as they want.
James, as far as you're concerned, brewing the stuff, do you see more responsible ways of marketing it?
When you can buy alcohol in a supermarket cheaper than bottled water or milk, and there's no duty on the water or the milk, then I think there is a bit of an issue that needs addressing there.
I'm still hearing it's not really my fault, not much I can do beyond what we're doing.
I think that the...
So the marketing watchdog is blaming the drinkers, the licensing authority is blaming the pubs and clubs, and the brewer is blaming the supermarkets.
There is one thing that the industry are using, which is supported by the police. There's 16 pub watch schemes running through Oxfordshire. If they commit a crime in one premises, then they're banned from all the premises in that scheme. And for that right to drink in a town to be taken away, that's a very big incentive.
The drinks industry has got no wish to see its products misused and people ending up in here in A&E. That is why we are doing all we can through funding education and through marketing.
Terrifies me. If you're doing everything you can, we're going to have 1 million people. This is going to happen to next year and 1 million people the year after and 1 million people in perpetuity. If we're doing everything we can, we're stuffed, basically.
Well, in actual fact, we are making headway on this. I think you can halve the number of injuries. I don't think you'll halve it in a year. I don't think you'll halve it in 5 years. I think that in a generation, might do it, but but it's going to take that long through sustained campaigning to change the whole attitude that we have to drunkenness at the moment.
What we've seen during our crime audit in Oxford reveals that violent crime is quite different from the stuff of headlines. We saw none of the gun and knife crime that so regularly makes the news, but
instead, a lot of alcohol-fueled violence on the streets and in people's homes. So what is the truth about violent crime? Is it going up or down? Well, there's one man who knows the answer because he's been counting the injuries through violence since the 1980s.
Obviously, there are concerns about knife crime and gun crimes, and there are spikes in those things. But the generality of violence and the extent to which people are put in hospital, that's been decreasing. I'm convinced of that.
I find this very hard to square, what you're saying, mm-hmm. with what I'm reading, what I'm seeing on the news.
Well, from an A&E, from a casualty perspective, nationally in England and Wales, we've seen year-on-year decreases since 2000.
In fact, almost all long-term measures of violent crime support Professor Shepherd. But that just shows crime can be conquered. In any case, for victims, like those we met during our audit, the impact on their lives is immediate and sometimes huge. And we can't just leave crime to the police and to the courts. Even when the system is run well, only 1 in 100 cases results in prison, and only 1 in 30 ever gets resolved, which means that victims continue to feel let down.
We need to stop them becoming victims in the first place. And that means we've got to look for new, fresh, innovative solutions. Now, plainly, we are making progress by using scientific methods. We're beginning to map crime, track back violence to where it started, and that's helping us hold licensed premises to account, for example. And we are beginning to be less tolerant of aggression and drunkenness. But plainly, blame and justice simply aren't enough. We have to get in early before the crime has happened.
Jane, whom we met at the refuge, has resettled in another part of the country and is expecting the birth of her child. She gave evidence at her ex-partner's trial, but he was found not guilty. Laura has left the refuge too. She's moved out of Oxford and has got a new job. Johnny is backpacking around the globe. The man who bottled him pleaded guilty to grievous bodily harm and was sentenced to 9 months. Damien has recovered from his broken jaw and is back studying for his degree. He did report the attack to the police some 5 months later. No one has been charged. Malcolm is hoping to take another course at university or find a job as a carer. There have been no arrests for his street robbery. Christopher has left college and is now working at a sports centre. No one has been arrested for his mugging. Next week, I'll be looking at property crime, burglary, shoplifting, rip-offs and fraud. We'll see the distress it causes, but also how many solutions there are out there. That's The Truth About Crime next week. And explore more about the patterns of offending and how you can help prevent crime at our website bbc.co.uk/truthaboutcrime.
Coming up, it's not what you know, it's who you know. A new report on why Britain is still elitist. And a gold in Rome for Tom Daley, the teenage diver. That's next on BBC One.